Hello students, good morning. How are you? Hope you people are good and safe. Students, in this session we are going to learn about the same chapter, chapter 3 in chemistry, and the chapter name is structure of atom. Before we start off, let's have a quick recall of the previous session. Shall we start? Students, we started with atom. So what is atom and what is matter, and then invention of atom. Students, tell me, who was the first person to invent atom? Yes, Maharishi Kanner. And the three important theories put forward by the three scientists. The name of the three scientists are John Dalton, Sir J.J. Thomson, Ernest Rutherford. Right? So, we came to know about the theory of John Dalton, isn't it? So, let us continue with this chapter. Shall we start? Learning objectives. Students, in this session we are going to learn about J.J. Thomson's theory and why the atom is neutral, about the cathode ray experiment and electrons, and then anode ray experiment, and next is Rutherford's alpha scattering experiment, and so on. Students, come, we will enter into the world of J.J. Thomson. Students, in 1897, a British physicist, Sir J.J. Thomson, compared an atom to a watermelon. Let's see this. Thomson's theory proposed that an atom is like a watermelon. So, according to Thomson, an atom has positively charged particles like the red part of the watermelon, the red edible part that we eat. So, he compared that with an positively charged particles of an atom. Next, he told us that the negatively charged particles of an atom are like the embedded seeds. What is embedded? Embedded means to fix firmly in a surrounding mass. That is, here is telling us that the electrons are fixed firmly on an atom, like the seeds of a watermelon. So, according to Thomson, positive charge is like the red edible part and the negative charge is like a black seeds. So, students, now let us understand why an atom is a neutral. Neutral. Neutral means no charge. According to Thomson, an atom is electrically neutral because the number of positive and negative charges are equal. Let's take an example and understand this concept better. Suppose that there are 6 positive charges in an atom. So, according to Thomson, there will be 6 negative charges. Therefore, according to Thomson, plus 6 minus 6, yes, we all know plus 6 minus 6 is equal to 0, right? So, 0 means neutral. So, therefore, atom as a whole is neutral because number of positive and negative charges are equal. So, the first person to tell us about this equal positive and negative charges was none other than Sir J.J. Thomson. Now, let us see the experiment of cathode rays and who discovered the electrons. Cathode rays. William Crookes discovered cathode rays when he was studying electrical discharge in gases. Whereas, J. J.J. Thomson discovered that the cathode rays consist of negatively charged particles called electrons. Students, now let us see the production of cathode rays. Cathode rays are produced in a discharge tube, hence discharge tube is generally referred to as the cathode ray tube. The cathode ray tube is a partially evacuated glass tube with cathode and anode placed at the ends of the tube. A vacuum pump is used to partially evacuate the tube. The cathode is connected to the power source with the help of a clip. The tube is supported on a stand. It was found that electric discharge through gases took place only when the pressure inside the tube is lower and the potential difference between the electrodes was high. To produce cathode rays, high potential difference of 10 kV to 20 kV is applied between electrodes and the pressure is reduced to 0.0001 millimeter of mercury by means of a vacuum pump. A glow is seen. You can see that? Yes. A glow is seen on the walls of the glass tube. The bright fluorescence glow is due to the strikers of the rays emitted by cathode. And these rays are called cathode rays. Now let us see properties of cathode rays. Cathode rays travel in straight line. When an opaque object is placed in the path of the cathode rays, a shadow is cast on the glass wall opposite to the cathode. This shows that cathode rays travels in a straight line. Cathode consists of negatively charged particles. The rays deflect towards the positive plate when the tube is exposed to an electric field. This is because the negatively charged particles in the cathode rays get attracted towards the positive plate. Cathode rays are deflect magnetic. When the tube is exposed to a magnetic field, the cathode rays follow a curved path showing that they are deflected by a magnetic field. Cathode rays produce X-rays when they impinge on a metal with a high atomic weight. Cathode rays travel with a high speed almost equal to the speed of the light and hence possesses kinetic energy. When cathode rays are made to fall on a pedal wheel, the wheel starts rotating, showing that the rays possesses kinetic energy. Students, that was a video about the experiment to demonstrate production of cathode rays. In 21st century, almost all places, including TV and computer monitors, used cathode ray tube. This CRT means cathode ray tube. This CRT contained 3 electron guns, each corresponding to red, green, blue fluorescent material. They cover the screen in a repeating pattern. This 3 color of light can mix to produce any color image. Today's cathode ray tube are obsolete. Obsolete means no longer produced or used, so out of date. Replaced with LED or LCD and plasma flat screen display. Now let us look what is electrons. Electrons are the negatively charged particles of atom. Together, all of the electrons of an atom create a negative charge that balances the positive charge of the protons in the atomic nucleus. after the discovery of electron, the first postulate. Postulate means fact or truth about something. So the first postulate of Dalton had to be given up. Presence of positive charge in an atom. If an atom is composed of only electrons, then atoms and matter should be negatively charged, right? The fact is that all matter and atoms are electrically neutral. Does it mean that atoms carry positively charged particles also? Yes, to explore this, Goldstein conducted an experiment. Come, let us have a look at that. Students, here is a diagrammatic representation of production of anode rays. In 1886, Goldstein used a modified type of discharge tube with a perforated cathode. Perforated means making a hole in a paper or a tube. He observed that certain rays travel in the direction opposite to that of the cathode rays, and these rays are called anode rays. He applied an electric field parallel to the path of anode rays. He observed that the path of the rays deflected towards cathode. Now let us check out the characteristics of anode rays in a small video.
Anode rays and its characteristics. Goldstein performed an experiment on the canal ray with perforated cathode. He observed that a glow emitted from the end of the tube near the cathode. Goldstein concluded that in addition to electrons or cathode rays that travel from the negatively charged cathode towards the positively charged anode, there is another ray that travels in the opposite direction, from the anode towards the cathode. Because these rays pass through the holes of cathode, Goldstein called them anode or canal rays. These rays are deflected by the electric field towards the negative end, and it also gets deflected by magnet. Hence he concluded that the rays constitute positively charged particles and are known as protons.
Students, what conclusion do you draw about the kind of charge of the anode rays? Yes, these rays contain positively charged particles and are called positive rays. The deflection of anode rays in an electric field was very little when compared to the deflection of cathode rays. Why is it so? Because the deflection of anode rays towards cathode depends on the type of gases taken inside the tube. And when hydrogen gas is taken inside a discharge tube, the deflection will be maximum. And the positive particles of hydrogen atoms are found to be lightest. These particles are called protons. Students, it was initially believed that electrons and protons are uniformly distributed. Rutherford conducted an experiment which changed the entire concept of distribution of electrons and protons in an atom. Come, let us watch the Rutherford's alpha ray scattering experiment. Rutherford's alpha scattering experiment. The credit for the discovery of the nucleus of an atom goes to a British physicist, Lord Ernest Rutherford. Here is a diagrammatic view of the famous gold foil experiment conducted by Lord Rutherford. The radioactive source rich in alpha particles was kept in a thick lead block with a narrow opening, The alpha particles were confined to a narrow beam by passing them through a lead sheet with a slit. An extremely thin foil of gold was bombarded with these fast-moving alpha particles. The scattered alpha particles were detected using a rotatable detector, which has a microscopic and a screen coated with zinc sulfate. The experiment setup was placed in a vacated chamber to prevent scattering by the air molecules. These striking particles called scintillations on the screen. Based on the observations, Lord Rutherford detected these conclusions. What are that? Here, as most of the alpha particles passed through the gold foil without any deflection, most of the space within the atoms is empty. As some of the alpha particles were deflected by large angles, they must have approached some positively charged region responsible for the deflection. This positively charged region is called the nucleus. As very few alpha particles experienced the deflection, it was concluded that the volume occupied by the nucleus is very small. Since alpha particles, which are comparatively denser, were deflected by the nucleus, it shows that almost the complete mass of the atom must be within the nucleus. Students, this experiment raised several questions, like why did most of the particles passes through the foil, and why did a few of them deflect from their original path through large angles, and why did a few of the alpha particles rebound. Students, actually Rutherford's model and experiment was failed. Why? Because Rutherford's model was unable to explain the stability of an atom. According to Rutherford's postulate, electrons revolve at a very high speed around a nucleus of an atom in a fixed orbit. Rutherford's theory was incomplete because it did not mention anything about the arrangement of electrons in the orbit. So based on this experiment, Rutherford proposed a set of assumptions. What are they? Come. Rutherford's assumptions. What are they? Positively charged particles of an atom are held together in the center of the atom. So it is called nucleus. And nucleus is surrounded by electrons. The volume of nucleus is small when compared to the volume of an atom. And then the mass of an atom is concentrated in the nucleus. The nucleus is positively charged, which is different in magnitude for different elements. So, in a neutral atom, the number of electrons outside the nucleus is equal to the number of positively charged particles in the nucleus. Rutherford noticed that atomic masses of different atoms could not be explained if only protons and electrons are present in them. He predicted that a kind of neutral particle with mass equal to that of proton must be present in the atom. Students, let us summarize what we have learned in this session. So we learned about J.J. Thomson's theory, next electrons and anode rays, Goldstein experiment of anode rays, and next characteristics of anode rays, next Rutherford's alpha scattering experiment, and assumptions of Rutherford's, etc. Right? So in next session, we will learn about Bohr's model experiment, atomic number and mass number, and isotopes. So students, go through the videos and note down the important points. Take care, students. Thank you.